لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله حق تقاته ولا تموتن إلا وأنتم مسلمون يا أيها الناس اتقوا ربكم الذي خلقكم من نفس واحدة وخلق منها زوجها وبث منهما رجالا كثيرا ونساء واتقوا الله الذي تساءلون به والأرحام إن الله كان عليكم رقيبا يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله وقولوا قولا سديدا يصلح لكم أعمالكم ويغفر لكم ذنوبكم ومن يطع الله ورسوله فقد فاز فوزا عظيما. أما بعد فإن أصدق الحديث كتاب الله وخير الهدي هدي محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم وشر الأمور محدثاتها وكل محدثة بدعة وكل بدعة ضلالة وكل ضلالة في النار. Indeed, all praise and thanks belong to Allah Azza wa Jal. As such, we praise Him, we thank Him, we seek His help, and we ask for His forgiveness. Whomsoever Allah guides, there's none can misguide. Whomsoever He allows to be led astray, there's none can guide. And I bear witness that there is nothing worthy of worship except for Allah Azza wa Jal alone, without any partner or associate. And I bear witness that Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is Allah's slave and His messenger and the seal of all the prophets alayhi salatu wa salam. And indeed, the best of speech is the speech of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and the best of guidance is that of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And the worst of affairs are the newly invented matters into this deen, the religious innovations, the bid'ah, for every bid'ah is the source of misguidance, and every misguidance leads to the hellfire. And Rasulullah subjected to the Qasa al Qumah. And indeed, brothers and sisters in Islam, in hadith related by Abi Hafsa, he says, قَالَ رَبَّنَا صَالِحٌ وَالْمَعْرُوفُ لِإِبْنِهِ يَا بُنَيَّ إنك لا تجد طعم حقيقة الإيمان حتى تعلم أن ما أصابك لم يكن ليخطئك وما أخطأك لم يكن ليصيبك. سمعت رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم يقول: إن أول ما خلق الله القلم. فقال له اكتب. قال ربي وماذا أكتب؟ قال اكتب مقادير كل شيء حتى تكون ساعة. يا بني إني سمعت رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم يقول: من مات على غير هذا فليس مني. وبعد الإصابة رضي الله عنه هي جلس في السنة at the time of death on his deathbed and he said my dear son, you will not get to taste the delight, the reality of pain. The reality of pain until you know what has come to you could not miss you. What has come to you cannot be far from you. And what has missed you cannot pass you by. I heard the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam say, the first thing which Allah created was the pen. And he asked it to write. And the pen said, what should I write? My Rabb. Allah says, write what was decreed about everything until the last hour is established. My dear son, I heard Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam say, he who has something other than this, then he's not of you, meaning he does not belong to you. In other words, if his son does not believe in this, then he is disowning his son. Ikhwani wa akhwatillah, the topic for the khutbah today is about one of the pillars of Iman, one of the pillars of our faith. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, throughout the book, throughout the Quran, he tells us about his authority and his power. So, by fact, when we believe in this pillar of faith that we are going to talk about in the Quran, it will give us a peace of mind about ourselves in this life. That is to believe in Al-Qadr. Al-Iman bil-Qadr khayrihi wa sharrihi min Allah ta'ala. To believe in faith, in destiny, in the predestination, the decree of Allah, the good of it, and the bad of it, as we perceive it, or what we perceive to be bad. This is part of our faith in Allah Azza wa Jalla. And we cannot be Muslims unless we believe in this decree of Allah Azza wa Jalla. That we believe that Allah has chosen something for us or something against us. This is by the qadr, by the decree of Allah Azza wa Jalla, and this is from our Iman. How do we react to that is another part of this. If you are patient upon the decree of Allah Azza wa Jalla, it is something which will grant you Jannah bi-Nillahi ta'ala. When you have
And sometimes my food is sincere, the only man say. When you have some rahmah, what has been decreed upon you from things which you don't like, things which you do not wish for. If you are patient upon that, Allah will give you things which you wish for in the akhirah, in general. If you have doubts about this pillar of faith, about this qadr of Allah Azza wa Jalla, then this is very detrimental to your iman in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So it's important for us to understand what this entails, you know, the belief about al qadr in Allah, the qadr of Allah Azza wa Jalla, the faith that we should have in this, and to be acquainted with it. So we don't make any mistakes and fall into kufr, wajah billah. Ali radiallahu anhu says, qadr Allah is still Allah bi khalqi. This is a secret of Allah in His creation, the decree of Allah. Because if you go too deep into it, you'll be lost. So we believe what we are commanded to believe in. And there's four aspects, four elements, four principles, which we must believe as Muslims in the qadr of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The first one of those is the ilm. The knowledge, that the knowledge is with Allah Azza wa Jalla. We believe that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He knows everything. He knows what happens in the past, what happens in the present, what will happen in the future. Allah even knows the hypothetical things. Like, if this was to happen, what would be the result of such? You know, hypothetical things. Allah knows everything. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He's aware of everything. That's why Allah says, إِنَّ اللَّهَ بِكُلِّ شَيْءٍ عَلِيمٍ. That Allah Azza wa Jalla, He is the overlord of everything. And this is established as well throughout the book of Allah Azza wa Jalla. The second aspect of the qadr is what is known as al-kitaba. This is the writing, meaning that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He wrote everything about the creation in Umm al-Kitab, also known as al-lawh al-mahfuz, the sacred tablet, the preserved tablet, which is with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He says, أَلَمْ تَعْلَمْ أَنَّ اللَّهَ يَعْلَمُ مَا فِي السَّمَاءِ وَالْأَرْضِ إِنَّ ذَلِكَ فِي كِتَابٍ إِنَّ ذَلِكَ عَلَى اللَّهِ يَسِيرٌ. Do we not know that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He knows what is in the heaven and the earth? Indeed, that is in a record. That is in a book. Indeed, that of Allah is easy. Likewise, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he says, كَتَبَ اللَّهُ مَخَافِيرَ الْقَدَرِ قَبْلَ أَنْ يَخْلُقَ السَّمَاوَاتِ وَالْأَرْضِ بِخَمْسِينَ أَلْفَ سَنَةٍ. Allah has written the ordained measures and the due proportions of the creation 50,000 years before the creation of the heavens and the earth. This is the second aspect. So we mentioned the ilm, the knowledge of Allah, the kitaba, that everything has been written. And the third one is al-mashi'ah, or al-irada, the will of Allah Azza wa Jalla. The will of Allah, the belief that Allah has willed everything that goes on in this universe. His will and His preordaining power effectively powers everything in this universe. Allah Azza wa Jalla, whatever He will occur, and whatever He did not will not occur. Whatever you want will not happen, unless Allah has already willed it. Allah says, وَمَا تَشَاءُونَ إِلَّا أَن يَشَاءَ اللَّهُ رَبُّ الْعَالَمِينَ. And you do not will except that Allah wills, the Lord of the world. This is the universal will that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala allows to pass. And this is also from His qadr, from His decree. The fourth aspect of al-qadr is al-qalb, the creation of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, meaning that Allah created everything, including what we do. Including what we do. Allah khaliqu kulli shay. Allah is the creator of everything. وَمَا خَلَقَكُمْ وَمَا تَعْمَلُونَ. Allah created you and that which you do. So qadr of Allah is also executed through our actions. إِنَّا كُلَّ شَيْءٍ خَلَقْنَاهُ قَدْرًا. Allah says, everything we created through qadr. Allah gave us the free will, of course. And the choice, the things that we do, we choose to do that ourselves. Allah says, وَهَدَيْنَا نَجْدَيْنِ. We showed you both paths. We showed you the good and the bad, and you are decided, and you are not forced to decide. Yet, this is under the will of Allah as well. It's executed under the will of Allah. Nothing escapes Allah's law, subhanahu wa ta'ala. And it will not, what you do will not contradict what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has done. In other words, our wishes, they cannot overrule the qadr of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So these are the four aspects of the qadr, and the things that happen in our life that we have no power over them. You know, you can't have your heart to stop breathing, for example. And when you're sweating, you cannot tell yourself to stop sweating. It's going to happen. If you stop at night and someone hits you from behind, it's something which is not in your control. And the fact that I'm here giving this khutbah today, and you decided to come here, this is your choice. No doubt, you're conscious of that. You know, but even that is under the will of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So it goes back to those four things that we mentioned, the four marathi of al-qadr, the four levels of qadr, you want to call them elements, principles, whatever. So the knowledge of Allah, the kitab, the writing, the mashiyah, the ruh of Allah ta'ala, and al-qadr, the creation of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and which are necessary for all of us to believe in. أَقُولُ مَا تَسْمَعُونَ وَحَمْدُ لِلَّهِ رَبِّ الْعَالَمِينَ. My dear brothers and sisters in Islam, we mentioned the four aspects of al-qadr, and that we said the knowledge of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the writing that has been written already in the book with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, everything that has been preordained, and also the will of Allah azza wa jal, and also the qadr, the creation of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. All of these are the maratib of al-qadr, the pre-decree of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Now sometimes we think of things that happened to us in the past, perhaps decisions we made which we regret, calamities which struck us as well, bad things, what seems to us to be bad at least. These things Allah says about that, وَمَا أَصَابَكُمْ وَمَا أَصَابَ مُصِيبَةٍ فِي الْأَرْضِ وَلَا فِي أَنفُسِكُمْ إِلَّا فِي كِتَابٍ مِنْ قَبْلِ أَنْ نَقْرَأَهَا إِنَّ ذَلِكَ عَلَى اللَّهِ يَسِيرٌ. So no disaster, no calamity strikes you or such upon earth or amongst yourselves, except that it is in the register, it is in the book of Allah before we bring it into existence, before we bring it into being. It is already with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is what Allah confirms in the book. Indeed, for that, for Allah is easy, then Allah says, لِكَيْتَ أَتَسَوْ عَلَى مَا تَعْتَمَ. In order that you may not be sad and grieved over the matters which you cannot attain, over the matters which you fail in. So don't be sad about that. The Prophet says, وَإِنَّ صَعْبَةَ شَيْءٌ فَلَا تَقُلْ لَوْلِ أَنِّي فَعَلْتُ كَانَ كَذَا وَكَذَا وَلَكِنْ قُلْ قَدَّرَ اللَّهُ وَمَا شَاءَ فَعَلَ. If anything affects you, of course, talking about bad things, do not say, if I have done so, such and such, then the result would have been such and such. If I didn't go there, this would never have happened. If, the Prophet says, don't say if. Don't say if regarding sins. But say, قَدَّرَ wa ma شَاءَ فَعَلَ. Allah has decreed this, and He does as He wishes, subhanahu wa ta'ala. فَإِنَّهُ تَفْتَحُ عَمَلَ الشَّيْطَانِ. The word if, this phrase, this utterance, this statement when you say if, opens the gate for shaitan. So shaitan comes in as soon as you say that, and you don't want shaitan to come in and mess with you. In other words, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He will that we go through a calamity, that we experience something like that, and we accept it. So we say, قَدَّرَ wa ma شَاءَ فَعَلَ, because there's nothing you can do about it. There's nothing you can do to change that. It's already meant to happen. So you accept the decree of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But, by the way, you can say it for future things. You know, if I had such and such money, I would donate it to the masjid. Right? You can say that, it's not a problem. The Prophet said it himself. If, he said, if I did not fear to make things harder for my ummah, I would have ordered them to use siwa every time before they pray. Right? So he said if, but he did not make it an obligation. So if for the future, you can say it's not a problem. But for things that have already taken place, especially calamities and stuff, we don't say if for those things, but we say qadarullahu wa ma shaa. So we say this pertaining to afflictions that may have befallen us. But we don't use the qadar. This is very important now. We don't use the qadar under the pretext of the sins that we commit, the evil which we do, the haram that we try to justify today. We don't say, I'm not praying because this is the qadar of Allah. We cannot say that. How do you know it's the qadar of Allah? You don't say that. But you don't justify your sins. And this is what it pleased him. He said, you're not avoiding, because you misguided me, Allah. The mushrikeen said the same thing. You know, he said, we will not have committed shirk with you, Allah. You know, if you did not go for that to occur. What does Allah say? قُلْ هَلْ إِنَّكُمْ مِنْ عِلْمٍ فَتُخْرِجُوهُ لَنَا إِنْ تَتَّبِعُونَ إِلَّا الظَّنَّ وَإِنْ أَنْتُمْ إِلَّا تَخْرُصُونَ. Allah says, say to them, do you have any proof? Do you have any knowledge that you can produce for us? You're only following your assumptions and you're only telling lies. Those who try to justify their sins and they insist upon doing that, do they have access to Allah's knowledge? Do they have access to Umm al-Kitab, access to the Lawful Mahfuz? They don't. They don't have knowledge of the unseen. So how can they claim that? So Allah says, do you have any knowledge, any proof that you can produce? Of course, they can't. Because they're relying on something which is majhul. It's unknown. It's just an assumption they're making. So this is from the way this is how they rely, the people from the past, the mushrikeen from the past, including Iblis, who was the chief of these people, in the sense that he's the one who is being followed and misguided. He's the one who used his rationale in the first place. Because you misguided him. This is what he said. And mushrikeen has said the same thing. So what we're doing is okay, in other words. Right? You're not doing anything wrong. But no. This is from the footsteps of Shaitan, which we should never say something like that. Never, ever. And we cannot justify our sins by saying this is the qadr of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. In fact, there's a famous story with Umar ibn Khattab and a thief. Umar is the leader of the Muslims, Amir al-Mu'mineen, and he will fight what is known as the Hajj. The execution upon is for certain penalties and punishments which are to be carried out by the leader of the Muslims in the Muslim land, of course. This man stole, and the punishment for that was to amputate his hand. He said, I stole, and this is the qadr of Allah. So Umar said, and it is the qadr of Allah that I will amputate your hand. Right? So, from the qadr of Allah to the qadr of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you cannot escape the qadr of Allah. And you cannot excuse yourself from sins by saying this is the qadr of Allah as a jinn. So this is for the past. As for the present, we acknowledge Allah's blessings upon us, the things that Allah has granted us. We say, MashaAllah. Allah has do this. MashaAllah. This is whatever Allah has will. TadarakAllah. Right? We acknowledge what Allah has given us. Also, a way, a means of removing the evil eye, al ayn, is to say, MashaAllah, upon those blessings which Allah has given you. That things which you possess. The second Surah Al-Kahf, that man who had the garden, he did not acknowledge the blessing from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He did not say, MashaAllah, la quwwata illa billah. He did not acknowledge that this is from the power of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So Allah took it away from him as a lesson. So we should also always say, MashaAllah, especially upon our kids and whatnot, you have a alhamdulillah nice house and so on and so forth, good family, say, MashaAllah, and thank Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, this is from Allah's will. You cannot do anything for that. You have money, say, MashaAllah. Allah provided me this. Allah put blessing in my risk, in my provision that you have given me. So you acknowledge this, it's from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and you cannot do anything, besides Allah being in control with His mighty power. As for the future, Allah says explicitly in the Quran, addressing the Prophet as a lesson for the whole Ummah. Allah says, وَلَا تَقُولَنَّ شَيْءٍ إِنِّي فَاعِلٌ ذَلِكَ غَدًا إِلَّا أَن يَشَاءَ اللَّهُ. And never say, never say of anything that I will do it tomorrow. I will do such and such a thing tomorrow. Except that you should say, Inshallah. If Allah wills. You don't know the future. Again, this ayah was revealed to the Prophet because of an incident where some people from the Jews and Mushrikeen who had doubts, they wanted to put the Prophet to the test. So they posed some questions there. He said, I will bring the answers tomorrow. But he did not say, Inshallah. And the answer came, they say, some scholars say maybe 15 days later, 2 weeks, 3 weeks later. But this was the lesson, because you should say, Inshallah, if Allah wills. And this is an expression that we use all the time. Every Muslim from any background, he knows the word Inshallah. And they use it, and they misuse it. Right? They say it, but they don't mean it. Sometimes you don't even trust people when they say Inshallah. Right? Because it means Inshallah, Mukram Alish. This is, in Egypt they say this. I'll be there in 5 minutes. But you will not be there in 5 minutes. You don't want to be there in 2 hours. Right? So he's saying Inshallah, but he's misusing this term. And this is dangerous. You should not play with these words like that. Say Inshallah, and you should mean it. And oftentimes, we don't know when we're supposed to say it either. Right? Or when we're not supposed to say it. Right? So for the future, we know you say Inshallah. I will do such and such, Inshallah. I will meet you there tomorrow, I will meet you there in 5 minutes, inshallah, you say that. But there's one thing which many people, many brothers and sisters, who make a mistake in the term inshallah. And that is where the Prophet says, do not say, wa Allah forgive me in shirkah. Allahumma forgive me in shirkah. Wa Allah forgive me, inshallah, basically. Wa Allah forgive me if you want. Do not say that. The Prophet says, do not say, oh Allah, forgive me, if you want. Rather say, Allah, forgive me. And the end of that, you can say, Ameen in the dua, right? Allah, and Ameen means Allah is sitting, Allah answered this prayer. That is the meaning of Ameen. So we should never say, may Allah give you tawfiq, inshallah. May Allah guide you, inshallah. May Allah make things easy for you, inshallah. Don't say, inshallah, in the dua, never. Because this is the order from the Prophet, والسلام, do not say that. In shaykhah. In shaykhah, in Arabic, you say to Allah, if you want to forgive me. No. But say, Ameen, if anything. Therefore, my dear brothers and sisters, as we conclude, this topic of Al-Qadr is very deep. It's not usually talked about in the khutbah, but because most of us, majority of Muslims, they don't attend halaqat, they don't attend knowledge sessions, you know, lectures. We have to mention these things in the khutbah as well from time to time, so we learn about these things. It's a very deep topic, which Imam Ahmed, alayhi rahmatullah, he summarized it with one word, really, with one statement. They asked him, what is Al-Qadr? He said, Al-Qadr, Qudratullah. The Qadr is the power of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That is the power of Allah. Who is the one who knows everything in the past, in the present, in the future? And even the hypothetical, you know, examples. Only Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So this is the power of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We should then be satisfied with the Qadr of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, what He has decreed. And this is what will make our soul competitive. You know, sometimes a person passes away, you know, so many people say, it wasn't his time to go. You know, it wasn't his time to go, he's too young. No, it was his time to go. Allah decreed it like that, right? It was his time to go, and you accept the decree of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And sometimes people cry and they wail over things which happened in the past, which brings about no benefit at all. No benefit at all. Rather, if a loved one, a beloved, passed away, don't waste your time in crying. No. Accept that it was his day to pass away, right? And that you cannot do anything to change it. And the only thing that will benefit now or her is your dua. That you make dua for them, bidin like that. So, moving forward, we should keep on doing the good deeds. This is what we should worry about, not what's going to happen in the future. It's already written. It's already written. We believe in this. But you don't worry about what's going to happen in the future. You do the good deeds within your capability and pleasing Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We depend on Allah and we take our precautions as well, because Qadr does not prevent us from taking our precautions. And know that أَنَّ مَا أَصَابَكَ لَمْ يَكُنْ لِيُخْطِئَ وَمَا أَخْطَأَكَ لَمْ يَكُنْ لِيُصِيبَ. Know that whatever has befallen you was, you know, could not have passed you by. And whatever has passed you by could not have befallen you. This is the reality of the Qadr. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make us of those who are at ease with the decree of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and what He has planned for us. Allahumma arina al-haqqa haqqan warzuqna ittiba'ahu wa arina al-batila batilan warzuqna ijtinabahu. اللهم علمنا ما ينفعنا وانفعنا بما علمتنا وزدنا علما. ربنا اغفر لنا ذنوبنا واسرافنا في امرنا وثبت اقدامنا وانصرنا على القوم الكافرين. اللهم لا تزغ قلوبنا بعد إذ هديتنا وهب لنا من لدنك رحمه انك انت الوهاب. ربنا امنا فاغفر لنا ذنوبنا وكفر عنا سيئاتنا وتوفنا مع الابرار. اللهم انصر الاسلام والمسلمين ودمر اعداءك اعداء الدين. اللهم انصر إخواننا المستضعفين في كل مكان ولا سيما في فلسطين. اللهم انصر إخواننا المستضعفين في كل مكان وفي شام وفي كشمير وفي كل مكان يا رب العالمين. اللهم كن لهم عونا ونصيرا. اللهم كن لهم عونا ونصيرا. اللهم كن لهم عونا ونصيرا. عباد الله، إن الله تعالى أمركم بأمره فبدأ به بنفسه، فقال جل من قائل علينا، إن الله وملائكته يصلون على النبي يا أيها الذين آمنوا صلوا عليه وسلموا تسليما. اللهم صل وسلم وبارك وأنعم على عبدك ورسولك محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين. آمين. الحمد لله رب العالمين.